Hey everyone, this is Ryan here, and I'm back with another prosthodontics video. In this one, we're going to start talking about the partial denture framework, which refers to all of the metal components of the partial. Particularly, we're going to look at major and minor connectors and what those are all about. So let's start with the major connector, and this is the thickest central component of the metal framework. So you can see an example for a maxillary major connector, and here is an example for a mandibular major connector. The primary function of the major connector is that it provides rigidity for the partial, and this is so critical and almost guaranteed to be at least involved in one question on the board exam. So definitely remember that the primary function of a major connector is to provide rigidity. I also think of the major connector like the chassis of a car that all of the other components are attached to. So it unites all of the other components of the framework, like the meshwork, the minor connectors, the rests, all things that we'll talk about in future videos. Also notice that the major connector is not placed on any movable tissue, but instead on bounded tissue, like the palate here or the lingual aspect of the mandibular alveolar ridge. All right, now let's go over some specific designs of these major connectors, and we'll start with maxillary major connectors. The first design is the complete palatal plate, which is the example we were just looking at, and this is the most rigid of all the designs. And it's indicated when all posterior teeth are missing bilaterally, which, like we talked about in our last video, would be classified as Kennedy class 1. Also, when you have periodontally compromised teeth, a shallow palatal vault, a small mouth, flat or flabby alveolar ridges. A lot of examples where the complete palatal plate is preferable because it's most rigid. And again, rigidity is the primary function of the major connector. The next design is the horseshoe design. And this is on the other end of the spectrum. It's the least rigid design. And you can sort of notice how much thinner it is when you compare it to the complete palatal plate. So it makes sense that it would be less strong, less rigid. And it's really only preferred to be used if there's a large palatal torus. And you can see how that would be helpful because the horseshoe design allows you to bypass and not interact with that torus if the patient didn't want to have it removed. And remember, when we talked about pre-prosthetic surgery, a big palatal torus should be removed if it interferes with the posterior palatal seal for a complete denture. But the nice thing for a partial denture like this, you could work around it with the horseshoe design if, again, the patient didn't want to go through that surgery. And lastly, we have a palatal strap design, which consists of a metal strap that goes from left to right. And all major connectors, not just the palatal strap, should cross the midline at a right angle. So if we were to draw a straight line down from the midline, you could see that where the framework crosses should roughly be perpendicular to that line. And you can see that to be true for all of these designs. For this horseshoe here, you can see where it crosses is again perpendicular to a line drawn from the midline, and same thing for this one. Now, what would be an example of not being perpendicular would be, say, if this came up through here like that and then came back down. And you could tell how that's just not an ideal design, not quite as rigid. So sticking with that right angle rule is important for major connector design. And then we have this concept of beading, which is exclusive for maxillary major connectors. And it involves scribing a 0.5, roughly, rounded groove in the cast at the borders of the major connector. And you can see where those bead lines are here. And you can see kind of, this would be considered a palatal strap design, and you can see how this line references the border of that major connector. Now you can think of this Think about the framework being fabricated on this master cast, and the metal would flow into these little bead lines and be a little bit thicker at the borders than it would be in the center, which is exactly what we want for added strength and firmer tissue contact, so that food is less likely to get trapped underneath this framework. All right, and now let's talk about some mandibular major connectors. First, we have the lingual bar design. And the lingual bar is preferred when the depth of the lingual vestibule is greater than or equal to 7 millimeters. And this is actually an important number to remember for the board exam. And the lingual vestibule is measured from the lingual gingival margin of these teeth to wherever the lingual frenum starts. So if there's greater than or equal to 7 millimeters between those two landmarks, then there's enough room to have this metal bar here without impinging on the musculature of the tongue. And this is the simplest and most common design. We also have the lingual plate. And this is used when the depth of the lingual vestibule is less than 7 millimeters. There are a couple other examples when we'd use it. There's additional tooth loss anticipated, some lingual tori that are in the way of the bar, or all posterior teeth are missing bilaterally. And you can notice how in this image, they nicely depict canine to canine. So all the posterior teeth are missing, get a little bit better support by having this plate here. Could potentially be a little bit less comfortable for the patient, but this could be a preferable design choice in these situations. So definitely remember sort of when you'd use a bar versus when you'd use a plate. And lastly, we have a labial bar, or sometimes called a swing lock design. And this is when there's a missing canine, you have unfavorable soft tissue contour, or questionable periodontal prognosis. So instead of a lingual bar, there's this labial bar, and the modified design would be where the labial bar has a hinge on one end and a locking mechanism at the other, hence why it's called swing lock. And lastly, we have the minor connectors, which there's a lot less to remember about these. They simply connect the major connector to the rests, indirect retainers, and clasps, which are all components that we'll cover in the next couple videos. So minor connectors, if I can get the pen here real quick, we talked about where the major connector would be all of this central thick metal component. And then let's get a different color. And you can see where the minor connectors sort of are the branches from the tree trunk that reach out and connect to the other components like the rests and clasps and other things that we'll talk about. So these are all of the minor connectors that you can see in this image. All right, so that's it for major and minor connectors. Stay tuned for more components of the framework as we go through more on prosthodontics together. Thanks so much for watching, everyone. I really appreciate it. We'll see you all in the next video.